Welcome to the FAIRmat tutorial series. My name is Markus Scheidtgen, and this is part of the first set of tutorials on publishing and exploring data with NOMAD. In this video, I explain how to use NOMAD search interface to identify interesting datasets and how to explore our processed data. We will focus on the web-based user interface, but this is also a good starting point if you plan to use the API to download and analyze data. Okay, this is the nomadlab.eu homepage. Today we are using the new version of NOMAD that is currently in public beta. Since the homepage will change soon, I put the link to the NOMAD version that we are working with into the video description. The Explore menu currently has two options. You can explore NOMAD based on entries or on materials. Entries are individual simulations, workflows, measurements. The materials can be explored with the NOMAD Encyclopedia, which offers a material-centric view on the data. In this video, we will concentrate on entries. There's a whole video series on the Encyclopedia that I will link in the video description. This is the main search interface. It will show you all the data that is visible to you. If you're not logged in, this would be all the publicly available data. Currently, there are about 12 million entries. Most of them are electronic structure calculation. As part of the FAIRmat project, we will extend this to other material science data, including sample data, characterization, experiments, and theoretical data on different scales. In fact, we already revised the search interface to allow the increasingly complex filter options that will be required for a wider range of entry types. The filter bar on the left allows you to create complex searches based from different perspectives. You can approach data from a material or structure perspective, or based on the used scientific method, or look for desired properties. Let's start simple and search based on the material structure. The Elements Formula tab, for example, allows you to filter for elements or specify a particular formula. Let's say I'm interested in titanium oxides. As I start to select elements, the UI will start searching. Each additional selection will narrow the search and decrease the number of remaining entries. You can also see the heat map change. The filters that you create by clicking are also shown in their respective sections. Here you can also remove individual filters or clear the whole search. There are different graphical elements like the periodic table, the number of elements, slider, or input fields for formulas, but the principle is always the same. This system also applies if you open another tab. The filters persist and you can add more and more filters from different perspectives. For example, I can limit my search to bicrystals with titanium and oxygen in them and that have cubic symmetry. Here you see that the choices I make also limit the available choices based on what is sensible within the remaining data. So if I set this to cubic symmetry, the Pearson notation Bravais lattice options get reduced to cubic as well. Another thing that you can do is to put items from any tab into the search page. This allows you to create your own search interface based on the filters that are important for you. So for example, if I drag out the periodic table and the symmetry, I can start using them side by side. This can help to understand the data by discovering relationships. If I fix it to oxygen here and now switch up the symmetries, I can see different patterns emerge on the periodic table. Of course, you have to decide for yourself if and how you want to interpret this. Remember, this has no intrinsic physical meaning as it's just indicative what happens in the data. Another option to build filters quickly is the search bar. If you type anything in it, NOMAD will search for it in various places and suggest matching filters. The search bar is a great place if you're not sure whether a filter exists or where it is. For example, when I enter a program name, a functional name, or the name of a colleague, I see that we also have filters for that. Let's have a brief look at the different filter tabs. Under Method, we can control the applied physics method, whether it's a simulation or an experiment, what simulation program was used, what DFT functional was used, etc. For example, I can set the use program to VASP and select a specific functional name. Under Properties, I can choose what calculated or measured information I want my data to show. Let's say I'm interested in electronic properties and want to see a band structure and density of states. We haven't talked about the Excel search results yet. Over here you find a list of all entries that fulfill the search criteria. It is the newest entry first. You can load more entries if you like. As with all lists, you can manipulate the columns with this button. Sortable columns can be clicked to change the order. If you click an entry, there's a brief overview with key metadata. At the left, we have metadata that were read from uploaded files by our parsers. In the middle, we see user-provided metadata. On the right, we have IDs and file names. If you click on the Details button, we navigate to the respective entry page. Here we get a general overview about this entry. On the left, we have some core metadata again. On the right, we see various cards that present available information. This is typically a card on the material, and depending on the properties, we get more cards. Here we see a card for the electronic properties that we searched for. The electronic properties cards shows us plots for the band structure and density of states. Those are connected and you can zoom and move them around. You also see a depiction of the Brillouin zone and information on possible band gaps. Now you have two options. First, you can look at the raw files. These are the uploaded files. We show all files in the same directory as they usually belong together. The main file for this entry is on top. In this case, it's a VASP run XML file. All the information in this entry was created from those files. You can preview the text files, download all or individual files. The second option is to look at the processed data, i.e. the results of the parsing and the normalization process. NOMAD puts all the data into a unified, hierarchical and machine processable format. This is then the basis for what we saw on the overview page, the information in the encyclopedia, and for all the search data that you can filter for. This is also an invaluable option for further analysis, as all data is presented in a structured and unified way independent of the code. While the availability of certain information may differ from code to code and from entry to entry, we still have the same structure for all entries. For a DFT simulation, for example, we always have a section run that represents the overall simulation run. And this run is structured into information about the simulated system, method parameters, and actual calculation results. If we go deeper in these sections, let's look at the system, for example, we find more subsections and eventually actual quantities. For the system, these are species, lattice vectors, or site positions. The values of these quantities are presented based on their type, shape, and unit. The underlying data are just numbers, and all additional presentation comes from the fact that all quantities are backed by a formal definition in NOMAD's schema. All definitions have a human-readable description, lattice vectors, for example, have the base type float, their shape is a 3x3 matrix, and the physical unit is length. The shape determines this matrix representation. The unit allows us to present the numbers in our compatible units. For example, we can always go from angstroms to meters and back. Quantity definitions also define relationships. For example, the shape of the site position depends on the number of species and atoms in the system. We can also look at all the possible definitions, independent of whether they are present in the current entry or not. Let's go to a different example. Here I selected an FHI Ames calculation with a geometry optimization. We see the same overall structure of the processed data and all the basic information is also present. One difference, however, is that we now have many triplets of systems, methods, and calculations. These make the different individual calculations of the geometry optimization. In these cases, the section workflow informs you about the underlying workflow. References allow you to directly jump to individual calculations or the final result calculation. Calculations are also linked with their respective method and system. This allows us to connect information within the single entry or even across entries. Since each entry can have different workflows and different properties, we added a section results that serves as a summary for the whole entry. In fact, the search is based on information in this section. The section results allows us to quickly and consistently gauge what an entry has to offer. In addition to the overall NOMAD schema, NOMAD parsers and entries can add more data that might only be sensible for a certain program or method. As a last example, let's have a look at a non-simulation entry. As NOMAD is stepping into the experimental world, we added data from the electron energy loss spectroscopy database that provides respective spectral information. Here we don't have a section run, but a section measurement instead. While the schema is completely different, the same schema system applies. We also have the section results, this time informing us that we have spectrum information as a provided property.
This concludes our tutorial on exploring data with NOMAD. In this video, we used the search interface to identify interesting datasets and look deep into NOMAD's processed data. This is a good starting point to familiarize yourself with how NOMAD represents data and what data is available. But eventually you want to do something with your data. In the next video on the NOMAD API, we are therefore going from looking at your data in the browser to working with data in Python. See you in the next video.